The net law is found in the back of the blue booklet or on page 68 of the Common Prayer. God spake these words and said, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt have none other gods but me.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not make for thyself any graven image, nor the likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor worship them.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Honor thy father and thy mother.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt do no murder.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not steal.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not bear false witness against thy neighbor.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline our hearts to keep this law.
Thou shalt not covet.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and write all these our laws in our hearts, we beseech thee.
Do not, Lord Jesus Christ, said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Thanks be to God.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
The kingdom of heaven is like unto a man that is an householder, which went out early in the morning to hire laborers into his vineyard. And when he had agreed with the laborers for a penny a day, he sent them into his vineyard. And he went out about the third hour, and saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and said unto them, Go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, I will give you. And they went their way. Again he went out about the sixth and ninth hour, and did likewise. And about the 11th hour he went out, and found others standing idle, and said unto them, Why stand ye here all the day idle? They say unto him, Because no man hath hired us. He said unto them, Go ye also into the vineyard, and whatsoever is right, that shall ye receive. So when even was come, the Lord of the vineyard said unto his steward, Call the laborers, and give them their hire, beginning from the last unto the first. And when they came that were hired about the 11th hour, they received every man a penny. But when the first came, they supposed that they should have received more. And they likewise received every man a penny. And when they had received it, they murmured against the good man of the house, saying, These last have wrought but 1 hour, and thou hast made them equal unto us, which have borne the burden and heat the day. But he answered one of them and said, Friend, I do thee no wrong. Didst not thou agree with me for a penny? Take that thine is, and go thy way. I will give unto this last, even as unto thee. Is it not lawful for me to do what I will with mine own? Is thine eye evil, because I am good? So the last shall be first, and the first last. For many be called, but few chosen.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Jesus.
whose kingdom is everlasting and power in heaven. Have mercy upon this whole land, and so rule the hearts of thy servants, the President of the United States, the Governor of this state, and all others in authority, that they, knowing whose ministers they are, may above all things seek thy honor and glory, and that we and all the people, duly considering whose authority they bear, may faithfully and obediently honor them according to thy blessed word and ordinance. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth ever, one God, world without end.
Amen. Amen.
O Lord God of hosts, stretch forth, we pray thee, thine almighty arm to strengthen and protect the armed forces of our country. Support them in the day of battle and in the time of peace. Keep them safe from all evil. Endue them with courage and loyalty, and grant that in all things they may serve without reproach. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, who hast created man in thine own image, who hast loved us even before thou formed us in the womb, grant us courage fearlessly to bear witness to the sacredness of all human life, especially the life of the weak, the enfeebled, and the unborn, and to make no peace with the culture of death. Bless with wisdom and courage all physicians and nurses, that they may regard every human creature with due reverence. Guide and direct those who make laws and public policy, that the rights of all persons may be upheld, most especially the right to life itself. Save thy church from cowardice and compromise. And finally, we beseech thee, cleanse our world from the evils of abortion, euthanasia, and suicide. All this we ask in the name of our Savior Christ, in whom is life and whose life is the light of men. Amen.
Amen.
Almighty God,
Father of all mercies, we, thine unworthy servants, do give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thy inestimable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost with us all evermore.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning. A couple of announcements. Today, as the grass withers and the flower faded, between Thursday and today, our heater in the parish hall has died. So I apologize for the cool temperatures there. I will call the technician and hopefully he can revive it shortly. Additionally, I'd like to draw your attention to a new issue of the Trinitarian, the Gazette of the Anglican Catholic Church, which is in the back of the nave. It's interesting to note this, that there is talk and good talk and a resolution to have unity within the continuing churches, those churches that find ourselves defending the traditional and orthodox expression of the Anglican faith. It's worth noting that with so much in the news of schism and distress in other parts of the Anglican world, it's nice to see that our own neck of the woods, that there's talk of unity and working together for the glory of God. Thank you.
Prior to the sermon, one absolutely delightful announcement. We mark by divine providence, Archbishop Ordinary of the Diocese of the South, the original province, the Anglican Catholic Church, intend, God willing, to ordain to the sacred order of priests the Reverend Richard Ross Tarsitano Deacon on Saturday, the 23rd of April, being the Feast of St. George, at 10 o'clock in the morning, in this year of our Lord 2016, at the Church of St. Michael and All Angels, Fleming Island, Florida.
If any of you know any impediment or just cause why this man ought not to be received into this sacred order, let him make it known to us. In token whereof we have hereunto ascribed our sign manual, affix the seal of this our diocese south on the 12th day of January, the octave of the Epiphany, in the year of our Lord 2016, and of our consecration the 19th. The Most Reverend Mark Haverland, Bishop Ordinary. I think probably all of you and I can say this today. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be all the way acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, and my strength and my redeemer.
Amen.
Back in the 40s and 50s, we had the privilege once a week, I believe, of walking from our classrooms with a dime or a quarter clutched in our hands to purchase a savings stamp to paste in the United States government war bonds book. When the book was full, we could carry it proudly to the local bank and exchange it for a savings bond, which when it was matured, we could cash in for education or whatever expense our parents deemed fit for it. 10 or 15 years after that, when my dad ran a service station in the late 50s and the early 60s, we gave out S&H green stamps, which were collected in a booklet like the ones of the savings bond, and which were taken to redemption centers and redeemed for prizes. These were temporal redemptions. The first paid for directly by a student. The second paid for indirectly as a reward for frequenting a business. On Resurrection Sunday, we celebrate spiritual redemption, fully paid for in advance on the cross of Calvary. When it came to bonds, we paid. When it came to prizes, the business paid. When it comes to eternal salvation, Jesus has paid. Please note the change in tense. The material things and the events were once and for all. Once you spent the bond or collected the prize, you had to start all over again. But the benefits of Christ once and for all sacrifice on Calvary keeps on going for eternity. Our eternal salvation keeps on being given to us. With the fact of eternal salvation paid for once and for all by Christ before us, my question would be, how can we look Christ paid, and the way we should live our lives as we move into the pre-Lent season today and Lent actually, as we remember Christ drawing ever nearer to the cross on Good Friday. I believe most of us have seen a picture portraying some scientists view the evolution of man from a primitive creature just out of the ocean, through the lower primates to the apes, to the hominids, and finally to Homo sapiens. A number of years ago, while I was teaching science, my own children bought me a marvelous work of art from an Avondale artist by the name of Scott Morphew. Somewhere between Surratt and Scratchport, his wonderful picture called An Array of Christ's Life, and which is almost a parody of the scientist's picture, starts with our Lord in the manger, then with him crawling, then kneeling in prayer, standing as a man, and blessing the people, then bearing the cross, then the empty tomb, followed by the glorious ascending Christ. In each portrayal, Jesus Christ is on the rise for us. He rose to the occasion, the scourge of sin once and for all, so that his one-time sacrifice might give us ongoing salvation, security, and sonship with him eternally. That's what he did for us. What we need to do for him during pre-Lent and Lent is the opposite of what he did. Instead of standing taller and taller, we need to bow lower and lower. This Sunday, we need to bow our heads in prayer and thank him for all that he has done for us. Next Sunday, we need to bow and offer our lives to him. Septuagesima, we need to fall on our knees and beg him to make his will for us known so that we may move toward him. Then on Ash Wednesday, we need to fall on all fours and to collect all that we are as we crawl toward the cross of Calvary. And Dottie and I are notorious for scavenging pecans. And as we go to get the best pecans to separate the best from the worst, we get down on all fours and we crawl under the trees and pick out the good and the bad. When you and I crawl toward Calvary this season, we need to pick up all that we have, the good, the bad, all that we are, so that when we finally reach Calvary, we can lay everything that we are at the foot of the cross of him who gave himself for us, so that he can crucify our lives with us and make us new in him. If you've ever been to San Juan de Beaupré or to the Franciscan Monastery in Washington, D.C.,
You know that there are paths in the gardens through which one may crawl, stopping at the stations to get indulgences for oneself or those who have already passed on. People in those situations crawl to avoid or to shorten purgatory. When we spiritually crawl toward Calvary, we're seeking a spiritual catharsis in our lives so that we, like St. John Baptist, may decrease and Christ in us may increase. When I consider my wonderful picture of Christ moving from his incarnation to his ascension, I try to envision moving toward him and giving him all that I have been so that I may be filled with him and will become all that I can be. We have to be very cautious as we move forward, to turn neither to the right nor to the left. The Lord set forth as he did before the Israelites, life and good, death and evil. Not once in our lives, nor once a year, but as we remember Christ's journey toward Calvary, this Lent and every moment of our lives, we need to focus. Shepherd tells us, Monsignor Roland Knox made the illuminating comment, that Septuagesima has an epistle, our epistle today, that warns us it's never too late to be damned, and a gospel that tells us it's never too late to be saved. We can either move away from Christ or toward him. Consider St. Paul's words to the Corinthians in our epistle. I'm going to hit you with them three times. I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. And I like classifies that a little bit. I do not run like a man running aimlessly. I do not fight like a man beating the air. No, I beat my body and make it my slave, that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified for the prize. And then, loosely from the Greek, I do not live my life in vain, and I do not shadow box with the problems over which I have no control. Instead, I take care of my body to the best of my ability, leave the rest to the Lord. I do not need to complain of all that besets my body beyond what modern medicine can do. Instead, I need to comfort others in physical and spiritual need, so that at the end of my race I may enter heaven, knowing that I've done the best with what the Lord has given me. That's the physical. The spiritual battles, just like the physical problems, but eternally more acute. Our spiritual problems can bog us down in our daily walk, and especially in our living preparations for our Lord's resurrection. We need to meet our problems in battle, to do our best to pass the rest on to the Lord. If we're faithful to hand over our problems to him on a regular basis, they will have all been lifted up and left hanging on his cross instead of weighing us down in our walk with him. In my picture of an array of Christ's life, our Lord stands taller and taller until he picks up his cross on that eternal Good Friday and bends under the weight of the cross, takes our sins upon his shoulder, only to leave them paid and forgiven when he rises first from the tomb and then ascends in glory, waiting with arms wide open for those who come to him. We can do no less than to bend our heads in prayer today, our shoulders next Sunday, and then fall on our knees from Ash Wednesday on until we can join together and proclaim, he is risen indeed. Those words have to be the most joyful cry to escape human lips throughout all eternity, and they don't have to be reserved for those of us who just managed to find our way into the Lord's sanctuary each Sunday. As Monsignor Knox noted, as we well know it, never too late to turn to Christ until we either die or the Lord returns. Our gospel has been seriously overpreached and overinterpreted, but there's always room at the end for those who will turn to Christ. Salvation depends not on our station in life. Onesimus was a slave. Emperor Constantine was an emperor. Salvation depends not on our age. We baptize both infants and adults. Neither does salvation depend upon the location. The Word of God needs to be brought to those in the inner city just as much as those in the wildest forest. All that we need to focus upon in our lives as we move toward Calvary, bowing ever lower as we approach the cross, is to claim Christ as our Lord and Savior. And as hymn 268 tells us, I bind unto myself the name, the strong name of the Trinity, by invocation of the same, the three in one, the one in three, of whom all nature hath creation, eternal Father, Spirit, Word, praise to the Lord of my salvation. Salvation is of Christ the Lord.
We may have been able to purchase savings bonds to redeem them for ourselves. We may have been able to collect stamps to redeem for prizes at the redemption centers. But salvation is only of Christ the Lord. Jesus Christ paid the price for our sins and redeemed us once and for all with his self-sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. And once again, as my picture shows, Christ, as he went through life, stood taller and taller until he bent under the weight of our sins on the cross. And when he arose straight and tall with open arms for those who will still come to him. Likewise, we should bow lower and lower until we're on our knees with the load of sin lifted from us and to move closer to him who has redeemed us as we approach Resurrection Day. Our pre-Lenten collects were written in fear and trepidation as our early church fathers feared for the worst as the Lombards invaded Rome. Today, Christianity is under attack here and all around the world, with the attacks sometimes being violent. This and the worries associated with the violence and shaky economy need not deter us the least from serving our risen Lord. He has already redeemed us from our sins and is waiting for us with open arms on Resurrection Day. May we move toward him rejoicing, as the hymn tells us. On our way rejoicing, gladly let us go. Conquereth hath our leader, vanquishes the foe. Christ without our safety, Christ within our joy. Indeed, with Christ in our hearts and our eyes looking toward our cross, toward his cross, what else can we do to move closer to him in joy? Let us pray. O God, by whom the meek are guided in judgment and light rises up in darkness for the godly, grant us in all our doubts and uncertainties the grace to ask what thou wouldst have us to do, that the spirit of wisdom may save us from false choices, that in thy light we may see light, and thy straight path may not stumble. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
God, the Father of all men.
May the Lord receive this sacrifice of thy hands to the praise and glory of his name, both to our benefit and that of all his holy church.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations, and to receive these our prayers which we offer to thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and comfort, and grant that all those who confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity in God the Lord. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops, especially to Mark our bishop, and other ministers, especially to thy servants, Lawrence and Richard, that they may both for their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and truly administer thy holy sacraments. To all thy people give thy heavenly grace, especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we must humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, especially that for the friends and loved ones of our parish family, for Bruce, for Carol, for George, for Cynthia, for Catherine, for Mary, for Mike, for Robert, for the Kairos team and guests, for Britta, for Dana, for Donna, for Sherry, for Anita, for Lily, for Gloria, for Frank, for Bob, for Francis, for Penny, for Sue, for Delcia, for Kimberly, for Colby, for Joseph, for Joe, for Norma, for Parker, for Bob, for Jennifer, for Jerry, for Pat, for Mary, for Larry, for Rita, for Delcia, for Sue, for thy servant Lawrence, and for all those in any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace to follow the good example, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
He who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, drawing on the faith. Take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your own confession, Almighty God, to thou art the Lord.
Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our mysteries. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, whose great mercy
hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him. Have mercy upon him. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comes to the words our Savior Christ said unto all those who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travel and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is his true saying, worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right, and our own duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name. Evermore praise thee. Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness. Mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Most humbly beseeching thee to grant for the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ. Through faith in his blood, we and all thy holy church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him, and all the world worthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice. Yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not wearing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world
known. Amen. Amen.
Oh,
And with thy spirit.
Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for the doubt of God's sanctity and swiftly received these holy mysteries, with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, that we're very members incorporated in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, for the merits of the most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end.
Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, who says that apostles' peace I give with you, my peace I give unto you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of thy church, and grant unto it that peace and unity which is according to thy will, who livest and reignest with the Father and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end.
Amen.
The peace of God which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.